We're here live at the Henderson County Public Schools Central Office here. We're here with leaders from the school system and the Henderson County Sheriff's Office for a Facebook Live roundtable discussion focused on school safety measures for this upcoming school year. Basically, essentially looking at what students and parents should expect to see this school year. So we're joined here from left to right. We have Major Frank Stout with the Sheriff's Office. We have Associate Superintendent John Bryant, and we also have Director of Safe Schools, Kent Parent, and Superintendent Bo Caldwell should be joining us shortly. So, gentlemen, thank you for being here. And then behind the camera, I'm here. I'm Andrew Munhank. I'm an education reporter with the Times News. So, I guess to start off, if we could, my first question is, so a number of school safety changes were implemented earlier in the school year. The past school year, following the Parkland, Florida shooting, and these included locking classroom doors, increasing lockdown drills, and ensuring entry systems at the middle and elementary schools were being used correctly. Just wondering how many of these changes are still going to be in effect, what is new, what has changed, and that sort of thing.
Right, and I'd love to speak to that part of it. As it comes down to our school system, you know, what we learn every time there's a crisis, whether it be in our community or another community, is it gives us an opportunity to kind of reevaluate what the expectations are within our own school system. And so those that you mentioned, Andrew, are those that are going to continue. When it comes down to the proper use of our access controls at the front entrances of each of our schools, locked classroom doors when students are present in those spaces, especially when we talk about attention and vigilance for our emergency procedure guides, our lockdown drills, continuing to practice those with more frequency. We intend to continue to do that because we realize that while there are events that certainly get notoriety and attention, like those that occur tragically in Parkland, much of our preparation is about the responsiveness that we're doing to any emergency situation, whether it be fire or a gas leak, or even just a security concern on the campus. And so attention to those expectations is simply going to continue. Superintendent, in fact, had an opportunity to share with our school leaders recently about that responsibility when we were at our administrative retreat, that those expectations that were shared in March will continue moving forward.
Okay. And just joining us here is Superintendent Bo Caldwell.
Sure, sorry I'm late. It's a busy time of year. August comes around. Preparing for 13,500 students, it gets hectic, so right. I apologize I'm late.
No, that's okay. My next question was, I believe, probably directed to Major Stout. Could you kind of tell me, you know, what you've heard from the school resource deputies that have already been in the schools, and also the deputies that have been filling in for the overtime? Just what have they been seeing, specifically last school year, with the rise in threats and kind of like that tension?
One of the things that we saw that really amazed us, Andrew, was the age of the children that were making some of the threats. You would tend to think that it may be towards high school students, but we even had some in the middle schools. We were dealing with 6th and 7th and 8th graders that, sadly, a lot of them thought it was a joke, and it was not a joke. We take this very seriously, and with the school system and law enforcement, we're going to take the appropriate action as swiftly as we can and quickly as we can. And there's no joking. This is not a hoax. It's not funny. And we really, really want to emphasize to the parents and to the children that may see this, it's not funny. And it will be taken very seriously. And you will be subject to arrest or a juvenile petition. You'll be in juvenile court. So that's one of the things that we saw with that was just the age of the children. And a lot of times they were writing it on the bathroom wall. They would write it on the classroom board if they didn't think anybody could see them. And then some of them were just bold enough to stand up right in the middle of classroom and say bomb. So, you know, we saw a lot of that. So we honestly during the summer hope that, you know, parents may have had some conversations with children. We want the parents to take some ownership here and speak with the children that, you know, there are consequences. There are serious consequences for this. It is not a joke. And if you can have that conversation, hopefully we can have a better year. But we really want parents to step up and have the communication with their children let them know that it's not funny, it is serious, and there are severe consequences.
If I could add to that as well, one of the things that I really have appreciated about the law enforcement present in our schools is there's also been this wonderful education opportunity taking place where those deputies are having those conversations with students on a regular basis. They're modeling responsible use of the words that we choose, responsible use of the actions that we present. You know, that it is not as simple as just responding to something, but so many of those law enforcement officers and our teaching staff and others are being really proactive about those expectations. Mm-hmm. And having them in all of our schools last year gave them opportunity to saddle up next to somebody and sort of say, let's talk about why it's important and why it's everybody's responsibility to make sure that schools are safe. Mm-hmm. And so I've really appreciated that about our law enforcement officers is they took advantage of not just being there to be able to respond to a need, ensure that schools were safe, but to be able to be really proactive about what we do and why we do it. And so they have been such an asset to us in a couple of ways.
Yeah, one thing I'd like to add to that, Andrew, is with social media, that's the world in which we live in. And you know, a lot of people get really brave fingers if they're at home or if they're away where they don't think anybody can see or know what's going on, but they get really brave with social media, and so they need to be very, very cognizant of what they post to social media. They really, really need to think before they push that button, because once it goes, they're not going to be able to get it back. And we do have tools and some abilities to gather that data to see where it came from and take the necessary arrest or procedures should we find out.
If parents are having that conversation at home, maybe the two most helpful piece of advice that I've learned as we've attended school safety conferences over the summer and continuing to refine our practices is every student should think this way, that if my parents were sitting on my right and law enforcement was sitting on my left, would I say and do what I'm about to write?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if everybody had that conversation at their dinner table, how powerful that would be. My parents are on my right, law enforcement's on the left. Would I be as courageous to say and do those kind of things? And if the answer to that is no, then that's a great indicator that what I'm about to say or do is not appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would love to see people share that thought, because I think if all 13,500 of our students were taught that way, that we'd be making smarter choices.
Thank you. My next question is focused on school construction. A number of the county commissioners earlier this year agreed to funding facility enhancements at the county school system to make the schools more secure, and wanted to ask what will these facility enhancements entail? What kind of school construction will be taking place throughout the year?
Absolutely. Kent's going to be able to give you a lot of detail associated with that, given his leadership and service as the Director of Capital Projects and School Safety. The part that I would kind of add as the initial is the work that's been going on this summer has essentially been sort of laying the groundwork for the work that will be going on all year. You know, when you think about this, I know there are a lot of folks that will show up at schools and expect to see many of the changes that were funded by the county commissioners on day one in August, but we've been reminding people, of course, when you start making architectural designs, when you're contracting with service providers and really making sure that we're making choices that serve the whole school system, both logistically and from a safety standpoint, the things that Kent will share with you are going to be facility enhancements that will be taking place all year long.
Yeah, so as John was saying, when we go into the schools, and one of the aspects that I bring to the table is that as a former administrator, I look at school operations as well. Falling under Mr. Caldwell's directive, that we do want to enhance our safety and security physically, but we still have to have school. So we're not going in there and putting bars on the walls and on the windows and things like that. So it takes a little bit of time to go in there with an architect and meet with the principal and make these changes to make a more secure environment, however, keep the school flow as normal as possible.
Mm-hmm.
After these enhancements are made. So we've been working with some architects and some construction folks, and we visited all of the schools to determine how we can make the double point entry system. Buzz into one area, secure area, and have IDs and everything checked, and then allow into the main corridor. And we'll be doing that at many of our elementary schools that don't have that capability. those will be our easier task in most cases. Some it's just a matter of putting a buzzer system in because we have an area that we can secure. So those will be happening quicker than some of the other things. But we get it as extensive as in, for instance, one elementary school, we may change the front and the back entry to create a secure area. And that's kind of a major project, so we want to get more stakeholders involved before we make final decisions on those. Mm-hmm. One of my areas of concern, I think it's shared by a lot of folks, is the high school perimeter security. At all of our high schools, we have multiple buildings, and students travel between those open spaces. But that means you have to secure each perimeter of those. So we've done a lot of talking to vendors and other contractors about putting a access control system in our high schools. And that access control system will allow those perimeter doors of each building to be controlled electronically. Placing those doors in an open mode during regular class transition times, when they are open though, we have the expectation and pretty much a requirement that those principals have a duty roster of adults monitoring those open doors during those transition times. And then when those transition times end, those doors will automatically lock. And then in order for allow students to go in between those during non-transitional times, we'll issue a credential to the faculty and staff as a hall pass. So if you were called from one building to another building, say to go to the principal's office or administrative office for whatever reason, then you would be issued that hall pass. And that would allow you access in between the buildings. But if you were just going perhaps to use a restroom, maybe you wouldn't get that pass, so you would stay in the confinements of that building. And if you exited the perimeter of that building, then you would have difficulty getting back in.
Right.
So it kind of reduces the student movement, and it secures our individual building perimeters. We've got 15 doors at East identified, and we've identified each one of those doors. We've also looked at a system that will integrate with our student management system. And so all the employees will be issued those credentials, and at the user level, the principals will be able to set parameters on those credentials. The other nice thing about it does monitor which credential is being used at every door.
Mm-hmm.
Which will help in law enforcement, or if you know things need to be investigated further, we'll have that data.
Okay.
I think one of the most important parts about that as well is one of the really nice parts about Kent's work and so many of the individuals that we've been working with is the opportunity to really consider scalability and helping to improve the efficiencies and the effectiveness of the school environment as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
Having this funding from the county commissioners, which is so appreciated to be able to tackle these projects, allows us to think both short-term and long-term.
Mm-hmm.
Like we're able to say it's so much more than just having a locked door in one place. It's thinking, how do we improve the condition of that school environment for years to come, not just kind of a knee-jerk response to what's going on. And so we've been able to think really thoughtfully about that, but much more broadly.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're utilizing, you know, professional construction companies and vendors who have expertise in that, who are making recommendations to us that are really helping us to sort of see, because this is a conversation that's going on all across the country right now. So there's a tension there that's really allowing for thoughtful decision making and opportunities to really scale that moving forward.
And another aspect that we've been directed by the board is to do a safety assessment of our facilities and policies. So we're doing that in a twofold measures. What our plan is: one, we're going to contract with Safe Havens and with a company to look at our policies and procedures. That is something that once we get that information back, and as we continue to look at policies and procedures from across the state, across the nation, we can act on that. We don't have to go to contract. We don't have to have construction happen. That's something that we're beginning to work on and continuing to work on. And then when we do our facilities assessment, we'll be looking at more of the fiscal security upgrades that we can do in the future. But those are the things that we're doing right now.
Okay.
Andrew, just a couple of comments about construction and safety plans. As Dr. Bryan said, we spent a lot of time this summer looking at different aspects of school safety. I had the opportunity to go to a North Carolina Safe School Summit and had got to hear the superintendent of Sandy Hook and talk about that experience and talk about basically a superintendent, here's some key points. The thing that he reminded us is your safety plan is never done. So I don't think that this issue, when you come and do this, and we appreciate you doing this interview, but you can come back next year and you can come back the following year. Because it's not like this is a one-and-done thing. Yes, we've got some money to do some construction. But next year, you're going to see more money asked to continue to enhance and improve our safety at our schools. So it's not like this is a 100% fix and we can just do this and we're done. We're going to continue to look at our facility. We will continue to look at our policies. We will continue to work with the local sheriff's department, police department to enhance it as much as we can continuously. This is not just, okay, 2018 and we're through. Because he kept saying, as Superintendent Sandy Hook, we realize now that sometimes mistakes were made and that we kind of felt like we had a plan in place and we never went back and reevaluated, never went back and looked to see how can we improve. And so I think in listening to him speak, and the other key point that he said, and he's probably already mentioned, but I'll say this again, is locked doors save lives. If you go back and look at Sandy Hook, you realize that the first door that that gunman went to, it was locked. And the superintendent, he said he could go talk and call those 20 kids that were in that room today. The next door he went to was unlocked. And he can't talk to those adults now. And so he's reminding us that everything that we can do is great, but locked doors saves lives. This construction that you also, yeah, we're getting ready to build some walls. We're getting ready that when you walk into an entrance and you have a beautiful entrance, that sometimes parents, when they're buzzed in, can wave at the secretary and just keep right on walking. Well, unfortunately, no, that's not going to happen anymore. Because now what you're going to see, that there might be some adult inconveniences. But we're going to ask adults to say, look, school safety is our priority. And if it causes an adult inconvenience, we're sorry. But our first number one priority is going to be our students and their safety. So, yes, when you're buzzing to the office where used to you may just have full access to the school, now there's going to be a while that you have to go into the office. And I think most of our parents do understand that. But just remember that sometimes when it comes to safety, there's sometimes... And you're right there, sir, that sometimes there may be some inconveniences. I also want to say this. As Henderson County Public Schools, he also asked how many school systems have athletic directors, countywide athletic directors. A lot of superintendents raise their hands. And then he comes back and says, how many counties right now have a safety director looking at safety facilities and safety policies and procedures at your schools? And a lot of hands went down. I was so proud of Henderson County and the guidance of our Board of Education and our county commissioners to realize, hey, this is important to us, and my hand continued to be raised through the work of Kent Parent. And all of a sudden, he looked at some of those people who were lowered, and he said, so athletics is really important, but school safety is not. In Henderson County, as I continue to raise my hand, that we did rearrange our maintenance staff, rearrange some positions, so we can make this an important position for us in Henderson County, that we have a safety director that's going to constantly go back and look at what we're doing, reflect on what we're doing. I sent him to Rockingham County yesterday. He drove to Rockingham. Why did he go to Rockingham? To see another school system, similar size, on what they're doing in that school system for school safety. To get better ideas, different ideas on how they're looking at it. So that's going to be part of his job. Yes, he's going to be looking here in Henderson County on how we can improve, but also his job is going to go explore what is other people doing that can make our school system safe.
Thank you. I'm switching gears over to the school resource deputies. In addition to the facility enhancement funding, the commissioners also agreed to funding an additional 14 school resource deputies to cover the public schools within the county's jurisdiction. And just wanted to ask Major Stout, what is the status of the hiring? Have all the deputies been hired? And if not, how will the gap be covered in the meantime until those deputies are hired?
Good question, sir. The commissioners, beginning the 1st of July, allotted 14 more school resource deputies. And we had a total of 9. Sergeant Ricky Bishop has retired, and so we'll be moving someone to a supervisor in that position. So, and we've hired 2. We got 1 that we will be hiring Monday, and 1 that will be hired the 1st of September. So we're moving forward. We've got a total of 12 in place, and we're taking applications for anybody that still may consider being a school resource deputy, and then we'll open it up for internal transfers should those that may be in the sheriff's office look for a new position later on. So it's in constant application process to fill those, and it takes some time to vet the people that we are that have the characteristics of the people that we're looking for. So the hiring process is ongoing. And so we've got part of the way through. But in the meantime, I will tell you, for next year, the upcoming school year, the county commissioners and the school board have agreed that they will fund deputies on their days off to continue to fill the elementary schools and the middle schools until all the personnel are hired for that. So don't worry, there will be deputies in the schools until we've got all 22 hired and up and running.
Okay. And I also wanted to note that for the 4 high schools in the city limits, the Hendersonville Police Department has hired more officers, so each school will be covered a first day of school with school resource officers. Major Stout, I also wanted to ask, you know, compared to hiring a traditional deputy, what are the traits that the sheriff's office is looking for in a, you know, school resource deputy compared to like a patrol, you know, on a regular patrol?
With a traditional deputy, you can take somebody straight out of what we call BLET, basic law enforcement training. And from there, you can go into an FTO process and begin your field training and move forward. What we're looking for with a school resource deputy, at a minimum, we're looking to have at least 2 years experience on the road, preferably more. We want somebody that's had the experience working in the community, that they have had life experience, the calls for service that they've dealt with, the ability to communicate with parents, with children. So you've got a lot of characteristics in a deputy that we're looking for that you're not going to get with a brand new deputy out of rookie school. So we're looking with somebody that's seasoned, got some years of service under their belt, but they've got the ability to communicate, the ability to care for these children. A lot of times they'll be dealing with children that may not have a lot of home life or a lot of support there or a mentor. So these guys and ladies can be a mentor to the children. They can be a very positive role model. So that comes with experience. That's what we're looking for, is people with a heart, with a passion for the children of our school. And we also want to look for somebody that's kind of like, you know, kind of like the sheepdog sitting up on the hill. They're overwatching those children. They're taking care of that school and that school system. They're very calm. They're very good while things are not going on. But when the wolf comes or the problems come, they can spring into action. So we're looking for somebody with courage, commitment, strong character, and a love for those children.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Major Stout. In addition to the school resource deputies, county commissioners also funded 8 social worker positions. So I wanted to talk about the mental health aspect of school safety. What will those social workers do in the school? What will be their responsibilities? You know, just how is the school system addressing the mental health aspect of school safety?
Absolutely. We've been very fortunate. Those positions that were funded by the county commissioners, we've been able to hire all 8 of those positions. Those folks will be starting with us at the start of the school calendar. And so we were really excited to see such an outpouring of interest in those positions, people from our community and even beyond, people outside the state, folks who wanted to come in and serve students in our county. in so many ways, you know, our social workers really serve as lead liaisons for community services for students and family. In a lot of ways, they can serve as the glue. They can serve as kind of an extra set of hands for our school counselors, really working for what we know. And the reason I say it that way is the words mental health have gotten a lot of attention as of late. But we tend to think of students as their whole health, you know, serving the whole child. And so social workers really will be point people when it comes down to knowing what the needs of individual students are. You know, that can be physical health, it can be social, emotional, it can be mental, it can be psychological. All of those elements kind of come into play in making sure that children feel that they're safe and that they're cared for and that they have outlets to resources when they're needed. Because sometimes that sense of need is because of a situation in their family that is outside of the child's control. And I think that that's something that we all recognize as educators is oftentimes what children are bringing to their school experience is not necessarily within their control. Mm-hmm. And so having social workers, school counselors, our support personnel really working as a multifaceted team, what they're going to be able to do is we now have greater expertise to serve students. You know, so many of us in education were trained for that as educators. It's nice to have other personnel, expertise with law enforcement, expertise with outside agencies in order that we can attend to all of that help. Certainly a couple of other levels to that, Andrew, are the continuing mental health first aid training that's going on in our school system. We continue to educate our staff, teaching them how to recognize what to do when you recognize an element of concern or a crisis with a student. And then another level to that, of course, is just making sure that we have really trauma-informed environments. You know, the most successful schools recognize, again, the individual need of the student, but they anticipate the future need of the student. And so we're most gifted in our service to kids when we can see a little bit into the future about what those students might need and then make sure that they're connected to the right service. So those social workers are going to be working in that function, and they'll be really supporting much of the work that's been needed, you know, within each of the school environments.
And Andrew, you look at different characteristics sometimes of the, as Frank said, the wolf. There's always, sometimes there's a disconnect between that student and school, disconnect between that school and family, life in general. I'm so pleased that our entire school system and all of our schools, because I think that when you go in our schools, it's about relationships. And the relationships that those teachers develop with those students. And making sure that if there is a lone wolf out there, that we as a school system, we help that lone wolf get back to us and develop a relationship. We've talked to principals about mentor programs. We've talked to principals about peer-to-peer type of relationships that they can do, that every student feels a part of that school. Because you go back and read, a lot of the characteristics a lot of times is this isolation. That a student feels isolated, that they have no one in their life, they don't care about no one cares about me, which sometimes leads to some very bad decisions. So as a school system, it's really important that we develop relationships with every child, and we know that there are some children out there that are hurting. And I certainly appreciate the way Dr. Brian explained, it's the glue. The social workers are going to be the glue. They're going to help those families in crisis, because a lot of times when there's a child in crisis, a lot of times there's family in crisis. And those social workers are going to help those families that are in crisis and be the connect, as he said, between the school and the families, and then those outside agencies that are out there that want to help, that a lot of times these families don't take advantage of. That social worker is going to be there to glue all of that together. But once again, I'm going to go back to relationships. It deals with relationships. The relationships of those social workers that they're going to have with those families is going to be so important.
My next question, I believe it'd probably be directed to the school administrators. So with the increase in lockdown drills that occurred earlier in the year, in the middle of last school year, wanted to see, you know, how often will these lockdown drills be conducted, you know, this upcoming school year, and how will parents be notified? How often will students be involved in these drills?
Yeah, you know, it's important to think about more than maybe just lockdown drills. We have lockdown drill schedules, and there'll be six that occur at each of our school sites. At different times of the day and with different people involved, sometimes, of course, involving the full student body, sometimes involving staff, sometimes involving emergency personnel and otherwise. But the reason I draw attention to that is because there are a number of emergency response drills that we practice all throughout the school year. We have tornado drills that we schedule. We have fire drills that we schedule. We have bus evacuation drills that we schedule. All of those things are preparedness opportunities for us. And so when it comes to the lockdown, late last year, families received notifications pretty frequently every time that a lockdown drill was occurring in our community, and that was through the help of our sheriff's office and our NICSIL alert program. We utilized that because there was a really heightened sensitivity to every time that action was occurring. It's not our intention at this time to notify people every time that we drill, because we don't. However, anytime an event occurs, we provide notifications on those dates, on the sites that they occur. Certainly, we're always going to be responsive to feedback in our community. I think that's one of the things that we did very well under Mr. Caldwell's leadership last year. Should we hear from people in our community that they desire more notifications about when we drill or how frequently we're drilling, we intend to do that. But oftentimes in our situation, we want people to be comfortable that we are training and preparing for those types of things, knowing that they're occurring with frequency, and that we're utilizing those in some different ways. You know, one of the opportunities that Mr. Parent and I learned about as we attended the Safe School Summit yesterday in Rockingham County was really advanced opportunities to train in different scenarios in different ways, whether it be with our leadership in the school system or with our school faculties or our response teams, our Safe Schools Advisory Committees, or even involving students in some of those activities. They need to know what to do and when to do it, and we need to be so familiar with those expectations that we're not having to think when there is a crisis response. But what we found is, as long as we are involving different people at different times, law enforcement being the perfect example of that, everybody sort of sees it through a different lens, and they're able to give us recommendations and reflections on all of our practice that help us improve that. So we're going to continue to see those lockdown drills occur along with all of our other emergency response drills, and our intention is to continue our notifications when there's an actual event so that we're communicating well with the community.
And as Andrew, you got to remember, a drill is a practice, the sheriff's department and the school system work great together, because you've got to make them to be as real life as you can. Of course, and when I say that, we certainly don't want to terrorize the children, but yet when I say real life is, we got to practice drills at different times. You can't just always do a drill at 9 o'clock in the morning. You've got to practice one sometime around lunchtime. You've got to practice one in the afternoon, because you never know, unfortunately, when something like that might occur. So therefore, when I say real life, it's different times of the day. It's not only just starting a drill. It's not only basically locking down. How do you end drills? When is the drill finished? It goes from start to finish. So therefore, I think it's important for us as administrators, as Dr. Bryant said, is yes, we're going to continue the drills, but then there's also going to be conversations. Each school has a safe school team at their schools. They're going to reflect on those drills. How did they do? We're going to also start doing more on basically tabletop drills. In other words, getting the safety team around together and start talking about, let's talk about this, let's talk about that. What happens if we have a major gas leak and we have to evacuate everybody in 5 minutes? Those are the types of drills that also are going to start with these tabletop conversations, including the sheriff's department, to make sure, as he said, they run as efficient as we can, and try to give them real life scenarios that make them think that all of a sudden this is what we've got to do to react.
Okay. My last question was just wanted to ask: are there any other tools that the school system has added to their belt for?
You're talking about the alert.
Not yet.
Go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there are a couple of pieces that are really exciting opportunities for us to better communicate with each other in the community. The first of those is the RAVE panic button application. It was deployed last year in the late spring. Again, through the leadership at the Henderson County Sheriff's Office, we were able to provide that application to two school administrators at each of our school sites. That's now being deployed to all county employees. So our entire staff have the ability to essentially direct communication to the 911 center for any type of emergency. Could be medical, could be fire, could be active shooter. We're certainly hopeful that that's not something we would ever have to deal with. But that immediate communication is powerful, because it not only connects us directly to the 911 center, but it allows for immediate communication, notifications of school administration, and can also be utilized to communicate within a school building. And that secure communication is something that we did not have previous to that. You know, in July, we also deployed our Report It, Don't Ignore It application, which is developed by our school system technology department. Really outstanding tool for any member of our community, student, parent, general citizen, to identify a student concern or a student in crisis. That can be any number of things that they feel like school personnel need to be made aware of. It also allows us to direct concerns to the sheriff's office if necessary, or connect somebody to a suicide prevention hotline. A number of resources really present through that application that simply didn't exist before. And I think the final piece of that is just to recognize that we still continue to have very active school safety advisory conversations across our school system. The one that occurs regularly under the superintendent's leadership is comprised of nearly every community agency you can imagine, whether it be the Department of Health, Juvenile Justice, local law enforcement, school administrators, parents, community members, leadership, outside agencies. That's a regular and ongoing dialogue where those individuals are reviewing our practices, making recommendations, having difficult conversations about what safety looks like moving forward, and making sure that we have all those voices at the table. Because as I said before, educators think of it through our unique lens. And the advent of that advisory committee really allows everybody to continue to bring that to the table.
I'd like to add that. The county commissioners were very kind and generous with the additional funds for tools. But the most important tool that we have is our human resource when it comes to safety and security. There's nothing that we can electronically replace that human resource. But there has to be a shift in the mindset of that human resource to bring that safety and security to the forefront, to be conscious of their surroundings. And we have such an emphasis on it now, unfortunately, but it is such a priority of the superintendent and in our district that we even named a position to do that, right? So that's an investment, but it also increases our faculty and staff awareness of the importance of that. We are never going to replace that person in securing that building. We're not going to, Mr. Caldwell mentioned that the classroom door that's locked will save lives. Somebody's got to lock it. And they can't just say, well, it's not going to happen here, so I'm just going to leave mine open because it's an inconvenience to have it locked. That's a mindset change that we have to work diligently on. And our roundtable scenarios that we'll be doing with the principals and the leadership of our school administrators needs to be worked down into the teachers and the faculty and staff. So that is something we can do without dollars, but it has to be diligently and prioritized and frequently brought up as, you know, this is how we do school now.
I'd like to jump in, Andrew, just to follow up with what Kent said. Goes back to the human resource there. And we encourage folks, if you see something on social media, don't fan the flame. Don't share it. Don't spread it on. Just contact law enforcement immediately. Let us start immediately trying to utilize the tools that we have to be in contact with the school administration, because I mean there is a whole set of dynamics that go into play when we get a threat or alert like that, and we begin immediately trying to track it down, to go to the home where it may have come from, find out where it came from, to put security measures in place, not only for the child but the family but the school system. So as he says, don't ignore a threat on social media, or don't fan the flame, don't spread it. Stop it. Notify law enforcement and work with us. Utilize your skills and abilities to help us make a difference.
Mm-hmm. I hope that everyone gets a sense that this is our top priority, and that when you look at student safety, it is so important for us that we're going to continue to look at it. Like I said earlier, it's just not a one-page plan that we're checking boxes off and we're done. We're going to continue to look at it. We're going to evaluate it. We're going to improve it because we want our children safe. Also, just to note, we do start school on Monday, August the 27th. Is that
27th.
Correct? And that, yes, as Dr. Bryant said, that some electronic locks are not going to be, they're going to be in place. With construction, the way things are happening, some things we've ordered are even on back order right now with Everyone, because everybody's buying the same thing, if that makes sense. So therefore, you know, but they're going. We're going to get there. And also, I just want to remind the parents and the community that on Monday, August 27th, slow down. There are going to be over 100 buses on the roads, traveling over 4,000 miles, hauling over 700 children or 7,000 children. Yes, traffic around schools is going to be tight. Be patient. The traffic patterns will iron themselves out once school starts. But please, just as a community, on August the 27th, watch out for those buses. Watch out for those big red flashing warning signs that bus is stopping, because that's also student safety. Because it's really big on sometimes, unfortunately, how many lives of children across the nation are hit by people who basically run past stop school buses. And I certainly don't want that to happen in Henderson County as well. Mm-hmm. So 27th, watch out for those big yellows and those big red flashing lights, and slow down, especially when you get around schools. It's going to be crowded. Just be patient, and you'll get the chance to drop your child off. And like I say, give yourself a little bit more time that first couple of weeks, because traffic's going to be heavy.
I think on that note, that concludes all the questions I had, unless anyone else wanted to say anything further. I believe that concludes the roundtable. Gentlemen, I appreciate you taking part of this, and thank you all for listening.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Andy.